What is up, YouTube? KM888 here with a deck profile and a regional recap for you guys. Last weekend, I entered the regionals, got top 8, 7th place by using DDD. Now, you have to realize it's a zoo dominated format. Actually, playing DDD and making the top 8, I'm really proud of myself, so I wanted to show you guys my deck profile. I'm gonna do it like this. First of all, I'll give you guys a quick deck profile, couple of tech choices will be explained, and afterwards I'll go further into detail about my matchups and what I might actually change for the next regionals. I'll also explain a couple of things. The regional was 72 players. Isn't a lot for you guys if you live in Germany or America, but for me as Belgian player, it's actually quite a lot for a simple regional, so I'm really happy. So, for deck profile first. A little bit standard at the beginning, triple Ragnarok, triple Copernicus, need to get off those combos, right? Triple Kepler. And then I've played three more Pendulums, all three are one-offs. One Thomas, one Apocalypse, and one Orthros. I can see you guys think already, oh my god, Apocalypse, turn off the video, end it here. Wait a second. Okay, I'm gonna explain these cards. The Thomas is still great for cycling, of course, for the easy rank 8 play. The Orthros just for when you're in grind game, and throughout the day actually happened a lot that I got into the grind game, and this card was amazing, just popping spells and traps left and right, so yeah. Now for the Apocalypse, you might all think I'm crazy, but the card is level 7. It allows me to make easy level 8 synchros, and without it, I wouldn't have been able to make the Siegfried Crystal Wing combination in a couple of situations, couple of duels. I was really happy I ran it because it helped me make my boards, and it was awesome. Also, its secondary effects, of course, allow it to special summon itself to the field in either my own turn or my opponent's turn in a different way. And I actually prevented one time to get OTK'd, so the Apocalypse was definitely handy. It was an amazing card in the tournament, so I was really happy that I played it. For the rest of the monsters, triple Swirl Slime, triple Necro Slime, all standard again. Triple Lamia, and that's it for the DDD lineup. So let me put these cards away. For hand traps, double Maxi. Maxi is amazing, and the format is defined by Maxi basically. So yeah, the card is needed. Double Ghost Ogre because Ghost Ogre is amazing. I haven't had much experience before this regional facing against Zodiac. So the first time I actually played against the Zodiac combo and I couldn't do anything about it, I totally misplayed my Ghost Ogre. I didn't know where to throw it, and it really cost me the game right there. But I don't really mind it. It was a learning experience for me, so I was really happy. And the last two monsters in my main deck are double Vanity's Fiend. This card, oh my god, it was amazing. Definitely the MVP of this regional for me. Whenever my opponent had Maxi, just dropping that Fiend, so freaking phenomenal. More than often, the opponent doesn't have an immediate out to it, so you can easily go into grind game modus with the Orthros, with your Dark Contract, with the Witch, and just poke him to death. I've had a couple of games where I summoned the Vanity Fiend, my opponent just scooped on me because they knew they didn't have an out, or they just didn't have the out in their hand and they saw what I have on my field, like this besides Secret or this beside the Crystal Wing, most of the time it's game, so yeah, that's really awesome. That's it for the monsters. For spells, playing Triple Gate, standard, and still playing the one Swamp King. Not really that an amazing card, I think. A lot of players think it's a substitute for your Swirl Slime in case you don't see it, or a substitute for your Necro Slime. But what those people often forget to mention is that you actually need two DDs to fuse that are irrelevant for your combo in your hand. When I have this, a lot of times I can't do my combo because I have to ditch two of my combo pieces. With the Swirl Slime, this becomes one of the fusion materials. The Swirl Slime itself is a fusion material, so you don't lose that many combo pieces, but it's there. It's great to get back, to get yourself back into the game, to still further your plays, and basically that's it. Then, Double Pot of Desires. I really hate drawing multiples of these. It happened once that I used Desires, drew to the second one. So dreadful, so hateful. Of course you'll lose that game, but yeah, it doesn't really matter, I guess. Pot of Desire is an amazing card, I really love it. Seeing you play all your combo pieces at 3, banishing 1 or 2 isn't that bad. But when you banish 3, you're pissed in yourself, it's really annoying. I had one game where I banished 3 Necro Slimes, and another game where I banished 3 Swirl Slimes and 3 Keplers. So I was like, how does that even happen? But I still won that game on Vanity's Fiend, so I mean, it's another win condition on itself, it's still great. But Bot of Desires, really unmissable, but playing 3 is overkill, so yeah. Triple Allure of Darkness. Seeing I do play the Vanity's Fiend, Anti-Apocalypse, I have additional darks in my deck, so the third Allure of Darkness really comes in clutch, I think. It's a really amazing card, and I... Like, a lot of DD players say that you only need to play 2, because the third one actually deprives you of your combo pieces. You're not going to keep drawing combo pieces. But the thing is, I never see 3. Like, I'm the guy who's lucky to see 1. but this regional, I think I opened Allure maybe 2 or 3 times out of 7 rounds, so it did its job. it was good, so yeah. And then 2 one-offs in 1-for-1, amazing card. If you see it and your opponent doesn't have max seeds, so phenomenal, so great. And then the Foolish Burial. Now, Foolish is a story on itself, because for this regional, I really thought it sucked. Every time I drew it, it wasn't convenient. I always had a combo in my hands to get Necro Slime and Lamia into the graveyard, so the Foolish Burial was so unnecessary. Of course, I can still send the Apocalypse to prevent me from getting OTK'd next turn, but in realization, it didn't move my game state. It kind of forced me in some defensive move, so I might cut the Foolish Burial, but I'll talk more about that after the deck profile. At least you guys can see my entire deck then. For traps, playing 4. Dark Contract with the Witch, I like it. Some DDD players don't play it. I think it's necessary for the grind game, so... if your opponent has Maxi, Ghost Ogre, whatever, or you just don't have an optimal hand, this card actually wins games. This, alongside the Orthros, makes for 2 pops during your own turn, and for 1 pop during your opponent's turn. This also gives Vanity's Fiend an additional 1000 boost in your opponent's turn. Getting over 3400 beta like that, not that easy. And next to this card, I'm playing 3 one-offs. As stated before with the Desires, I really don't like getting doubles in my hand. So the best trap in the game, Vanity's Emptiness, 1 Dimensional Barrier, and 1 Anti-Spell. The thing with these cards is actually amazing, because in testing I opened up with Double Dimensional Barrier so often, it just freaking blew my mind, I hated it. I could only use 1, it was a dead card in my hand. But when I changed it and I had these 3, and I drew 2 out of them, it didn't matter which ones, I always won the game. Like, having Anti-Spell and Vanity's Emptiness behind the Secret or behind the Crystal Wing is so good, you always win. Having 2 dimensional barriers doesn't help you win, because the second one, it's just there. Like, you only need a second dimensional barrier, maybe against Zodiac. Of course, the format is Zodiac defined, but... you're not always going to go first. If you're going first against Zodiac, definitely side the second one in, maybe even a third. But yeah, I don't really like it that much to draw multiples of. It's a great card, but you have to see when you play it, so yeah. For extra deck, this might actually undergo some changes afterwards, but more of that in the future. Double Flame King Genghis. Genghis is amazing. In your combos, you often summon two already, so people bump it up to three to get more of the combos, but you go into grind game a lot more than you think, and then two is really enough because the other fusions are actually more important. Then one Oracle King Dark. The card itself is actually bad, but having a 2/8 beater is really good, so I might bump this up to 2 again. Against Zodiac, I had a couple of situations where I actually needed a second Dark, so yeah. And then one Beowulf to round up the fusions. For Synchros, playing the Formula Synchron and Hyper Librarian. Combo is busted, it's really good. For level 7s, Gust King Alexander and Odd-Eyes Meteor Burst Dragon. These cards were also phenomenal. I used them a lot. It really helps to get through your cards. It really helps to get your combo pieces going, so yeah. Then the mandatory Siegfried Crystal Wing. You make this board so often it hurts. So yeah. And then because I played the Apocalypse with the Lamia, it's actually an easy level 8 synchro play. I've been playing three more level 8s. The first one being Omega. The thing is, you need Omega because it's another card you can summon. It can dodge other cards. It's really good, Omega. It's just that generic level 8 synchro that you need. The one Scarlight Red Dragon Archfiend. I've been playing it to be able to OTK even through my Ragnarok effect, which I'm surprised I can actually do. One game, I was able to go for OTK even through my own half battle damage kind of situation. And it just didn't work out because my opponent had a Swordsman of Revealing Light in Chainburn deck. Was pretty stupid to get that against me, but just the fact that I had a Scarlight allowed me to go for the OTK, and it's so convenient in a lot of situations. Just the fact that it doesn't target, blows everything up that's below him, and then you can still attack with the Scarlight is so good, so yeah. Scarlight, definitely a good card, not gonna cut it. Crimson Blader, might be a weird choice for you guys, but I decided to play it because of Kaijus. When you run over a monster, your opponent cannot Kaiju you. That's really important for your Siegfried, for your Crystal Wing, and to keep your board, which is definitely an amazing, feature. I might cut the Crimson Blader, I might cut the Crimson Blader though, because it's the only card in my entire extra deck that I haven't made. And that I also didn't feel the need to make. The thing is, you know your opponent can Kaiju you, but you rather go for Siegfried Crystal Wing than you go for the Crimson Blader. Zodiac is really prominent, and they don't have to go with the Kaijus. If you don't have Siegfried, if you don't have the Crystal Wing, they can just as well go for their Zodiac play with either a Barrage or a Theratops. So yeah, the Crimson Blader was pretty irrelevant this weekend, and I might cut it for the second Dark. And then to round up the extra deck, these are all the synchros, by the way. We have one Kali Yuga and one Hope Harbinger Dragon Titanic Galaxy. The Kali Yuga, definitely an MVP of the extra deck. Just making sure your opponent cannot do a thing is so brutal. And then side deck, probably the most important thing of a tournament. This side deck is gonna get a lot of tweaks, I'm pretty sure of it. I saw what worked and what didn't work, so yeah. First of all, triple Dengo Sekka. Best freaking card ever. There are so many decks that play back row. Like, even if you come against Zodiac, they have dimensional barriers. There are decks that play Sanctum. Like, not every player is gonna flip over that Sanctum in the draw phase. And if you go standby phase, just summon a Denko, you can't get Sanctumed into Scythe, and everything's going well for you from there on out. The card is continuous, so they can't even chain things. Everybody knows already, I think, but Denko Sekka is awesome. Like, in a deck like this, you don't really need your normal summon. At least not that often. Sometimes you do, but most of the time you don't. And just playing cards like Denko Sekka and Vanity's Fiend really help in a lot of cases. Speaking of Vanity's Fiend, I'm actually citing the third one, the third copy. The card is amazing against Infernoid, the card is amazing against Yang Xing, and so many other decks. Like, even if you go against Zodiac, summon Vanity's Fiend. If they don't have Raigeki or Darkhold or Book of Moon, you win. Simple as that. If they don't have that immediate out, you win. And if they don't have Maxi and you go for Siegfried first, put that Vanity's Fiend beside it. Most of the time, they can't do a thing. It's so ridiculous. It's amazing. So the third copy is too good. Against Infernoid, their only out is Decatron. And again, Raigeki and Darkhold, they can't even Kaiju you because that's counts as a special summon. So Vanity Fiend, too freaking awesome. That's it for the monsters. Spells, basically monster wipes. Raigeki, double Darkhold, too good. Can't say more about it. I went up against Eidolon or Invoked, as they are now called, so many times. It's actually the thing I played most against, I think. That and Zoo, of course. But just being able to wipe boards is so good because you barely live. They have a lot of big monsters, and the Markabai is the only thing that can negate stuff. And if you lure that out, you can easily Darkhold or Raigeki, Slumber even. I mean, it's so easy to get rid of those. Source of Concealing Light. Amazing card. The thing I cited in the most for is probably the Wind Witches, because an undestructible Crystal Wing is so annoying. Things like Swords of Concealing Light don't target, they just put it face down. You get over Crystal Wing easily then. Book of Eclipse, same thing as with the Swords of Concealing Light, but I like one of each. Because the Eclipse can also save you during the battle phase, so yeah. Then, one Book of Moon. Not so sure about this card, if I'm gonna play it again. I saw it once, and it was irrelevant, because I already would win the game anyway. But, in theory, it's a good card. Maybe not in this deck, so I might cut it. We'll see about that. And then definitely an MVP of this side deck, next to the Denko Sekka. Triple Forbidden Chalice. The card is amazing. Not only does it negate stuff from your opponents, it also turns off your own Vanity's Fiend. Done that a couple of times where I had the Vanity's Fiend, I was forced into it thanks to Maxi. And I wouldn't be able to win on time because, well, time is also a factor, but my Dark Contracts make me lose life as well. And as my monsters aren't that strong, like Copernicus, Kepler, they all have zero attack. Lamia has 100, Swirlslime 200. They're all really small, so one turn you just make sure you have enough resources, chalice your own Vanity's Fiend, give it 400 more attacks even, and then you can special summon all out and win from there. So yeah, chalice, really amazing card. Last two cards in the side deck are one more Dimensional Barrier. For me, I like it at 2. I think 3 might be too much. It could be good, but I'm really doubtful about the second one already. So yeah, the third one might be too much for me. But I like it at 2 against Zodiac when going first. So yeah. And then the final card, Full Force Virus. I haven't seen it all weekend. Even if I saw it, I don't think I would have won the games that I cited it in, because at those points my opponent had both a Barrage and a Terror Top in their hand. So even if they went Terror Top into Rat Pier and I Full Force Virus them on the right time, they still had Barrage, they still would have gone off, and I still would have lost that game. So yeah. So that was it for the deck profile. If you have questions for me, besides what I already explained, you can always ask them. You can always ask away in the comments below, or if you know me in person, just ask me. I'm always willing to answer. And besides all that, I guess I'm gonna explain a bit about the tournament itself. It was a regional in Ghent, 72 people entered. Was a big turnout, actually, so I'm really happy. And I had a lot of different matchups, so I don't think I played the same kind of deck twice, but it really was awesome. So let me explain the decks I went up against. The first round I went up against Chainburn. Most people would already be like, oh my god, not this kind of shit. I better hope Denkoseka game 2 and 3 and win. But I didn't win on Denkoseka. I didn't even draw it. Kali Yuga, Oracle King, stuff like that actually are really good against those things. So I went 2-1. That's a game where I actually lost even with the Scarlight. But yeah, 2-1 against Chainburn, I was really happy. Second duel was against Zodiac Yang Xing. The player itself was amazing, so it was really scary for me. I knew him from all the YouTube videos I've seen on Lithium's channel. But knowing the guy, I also knew he was going to play some kind of Yang Xing variant. So things like Vanity's Fiend and Vanity's Emptiness actually won me the game. I didn't even have to try too much. So knowledge is key. So yeah, when I won 2-0, I was really happy. Then I dueled against a 60 card deck, invoked Zodiac Sworn. Was really amazing to see how a 60 card deck actually works in real life. Was the first time I actually went up against one. But I won it 2-0 as well. Just locking them out of the duel with Siegfried and Crystal Wing is so much fun. It's not even funny. Then, going 3-0 at that point, I lost my first match against Zodiac Kaiju. The guy won the tournament, so really congrats to him, Florian. He did really well. That's also where I made my misplay with the Ghost Ogre. I definitely would have been able to Ghost Ogre the Tiger Mortar and prevented any other plays, but I didn't really know where to hit the combo. So yeah, I lost that 1-0-2. Yeah, game 2 had total control. I couldn't do a thing. I opened bad and yeah, it wasn't really that hard for him to win right there. Afterwards, the 60 card Zodiac Metal Foe deck. The guy ended up, I think, 3rd or 4th place in the tournament. So again, really props to the guy for making it with Zodiac Metal Foes. 60 card deck without grass looks greener just because of the fact that you aren't fucked against other 60 card decks is so great. Was an amazing duel which I lost 1-2, but I can say that Denkoseka was really good against the deck, and I'm definitely gonna play more with the Denko in my sights. The duel itself was amazing. It was really awesome to play like that. Really good grind game, and yeah, it's in my eyes, it's duels like that made formats really cool. The sixth match was against Invoked Blue Eyes, which I won 2-0. Really quick match again, the first one with my Vanity's Fiend. The second match was a bit longer, but with the help of Raigeki, Dark Hole, stuff like that, I actually broke through his boards and I could easily make games, so yeah, I was happy. And then the final match, finally, again, not a deck that was playing Invoked or Zodiac, Kaiju Demise, Cosmo Demise, excuse me. I won the game 2-0. I was really scared of the back row, but Denkoseka and Kali Yuga are really such awesome cards, so yeah. Again, the two games where I lost were against the players that were actually sitting at table one in the final round. So I'm not even mad I lost those. Were cool matches, and I'm happy about my result. Possible changes might include that Full Force Virus, the Book of Moon, maybe even the Foolish Burial. And it could also be a good idea to change up that Crimson Blader. So yeah, things like My Body as a Shield could come in. It's a good card, it helps a lot, and I feel like if I had it a couple of times, I would have won easier at some points, and I would have won some of the games that I lost, so yeah. Although the Foolish Burial wasn't that great now, it might still be good in the next regional, so I have to test it a little bit, but yeah. I'm guessing that was it that I have to tell you guys. I had really a lot of fun. I loved the tournament. It was my first time in Outpost Ghent for a regional, and I loved being there. A lot of cool guys, and I loved the experience. So yeah, up to next week where I'm going to the regional in Antwerp. I'll see what I do. So yeah. For now, if you have any more questions, just comment them, just fire away. Everything else, maybe like the video, I love it. And I see you guys the next time. See ya!